hello again, and today was the day that I was going to get to New Orleans and finally have a break. I had all this gear in a bag that I was going to ship back to Miami Beach because I was super overloaded, and this sort of marked the end of the ultra boring roads. I'd given myself around about 10 days to get from Miami to LA, and I've spoken in previous videos how I wanted to ship my bike from Miami to LA originally, and things didn't work out, and I had to make a pretty quick decision on what I was going to do, and basically it was going to be shooting to LA. I eventually took some turn-offs after I decided that it's ridiculous just riding full on every single day, and I decided that I'll go to the Grand Canyon. I'll do some riding on some of the famous roads in California, and so I took a little bit longer. But this sort of this was the third big day of riding in a row, and I was looking forward to a couple of days break here in New Orleans, which is one of my favorite cities that I've visited in the US. Not so much the big tourist area, but there's so much to see, and it's a city steeped in history, both good and bad. And I just wanted to have a couple of days, and so I booked a decent sort of hotel instead of the normal motels that I've been staying in. Although the place I stayed in, Laguna Beach, was very, very nice, and that was an unplanned one. I just decided I was going to stop short of Laguna Beach, but I decided to keep riding the day before because I was feeling pretty good, and the weather had just cooled off a little bit, and so it allowed me to do an extra 2 or 3 hours. So this day was a shorter day's ride, and I was really looking forward to having a lot shorter ride, and basically. The ride ended up being, I think it was about 7 hours, no, about 5-6 hours, sorry. So I was able to take my time a little bit more and enjoy it because the first few days were not really enjoyable as far as riding goes. I mean, you've just got, the thing about toll roads are that the owners are private owners or private public, and they don't think about the roads they build. What they do is they build a big long straight highway to get trucks. They're built for the people, but they're built mainly for the delivery of goods, and so they're just big, long and straight, and everybody's the speed limits are 65-70, and everyone's doing 85-90, and you can't not do that speed. If you're on a motorbike and you're doing 65-70, whatever the speed limit is, you're just continually being overtaken by trucks and cars and all that, and it's not safe. It's nowhere near as safe as it's safer to actually go over the speed limit, which sounds ridiculous, but it just is. So this trip took me about 530 kilometers, I think about 330 miles. It took me about 7 hours, but I had a few stops off. I crossed from Florida into Alabama I ended up in New Orleans, Louisiana. And I went through Florida, Alabama, Missouri, and ended in New Orleans, which is a great town. And plus, this was the start of I had some options for the roads I was taking rather than taking the big main freeways, tollways. And another thing about tollways, as you find out, is they don't have any stops. So there's no sort of rest areas they don't think of tourism, they don't think of people on who are going on these adventures or anything like that. The only chance you get to stop is gas stations, you know, which is pretty sad. And it's designed like that for a reason. These gas stations pay probably a premium to be there, and so that the only chance to get food. So it's pretty sad because you don't get those ma and pup shops like you do in Central and South America in all the towns, because they basically bypass the towns, and except for the major cities. So yeah, I was really looking forward to getting to New Orleans and getting the bike. Getting the bike giving the bike a couple of days rest, checking over everything, just giving my body a bit of a rest after so much riding. But I was really starting to get into it now. I was really starting to enjoy it, and I was learning things along the way. You know, I originally planned to stop once every 3 hours, and that just wasn't working. And I was basically stopping once every 2 hours and really looking forward to those little breaks. So what I tried to do was get off the highway and go into the towns and get a drink and then, you know, whatever I could, get to a nice little park. A lot of the towns have, you know, beautiful little parks with a little bench I could basically lay down on for 15 to 30 minutes. So I think I had about 2 hours of break time between. So the trip ended up taking me around about 7 hours. And I was pretty happy about that. So a couple of things that I was thinking about while I was on the trip was, while I was on this third day was just how, how boring the roads were. Especially the freeways, and especially when it's nice when you've got some rivers and lakes to go over and stuff like that. But these are designed pretty badly, you know, these freeways. They're just big blocks of concrete all the way for bridges, and so there's no sort of like you don't get a feel of the cities. And I was hoping that once I got to New Orleans, the cities after that I could go off onto Route 10 and 50, 12, and jump in and off those routes by going on some of the smaller roads that follow the coast and through the Bayou and the Everglades type scenarios. So what I wanted to talk about in this one was the choice of my gear, my riding gear. So I basically, I had the Climb Overlander pants and jacket. I've got the Badlands one at home. The Badlands ones are the big bulletproof buggers, and they're quite heavy, and they are, you know, the heat out of them is pretty taxing, you know. And so I decided to take the Overlander, and I'm glad I did. They've got some pockets on the legs that allow you to breathe, get some air through them. And there's one on under your bum as well, but I don't know how that actually works. Maybe when you're off the bike, it works better. And then on the jacket, there's one at the front as well, and there's a couple other little pockets you can unzip to get some air through the place. So actually, when you're riding at some sort of speed, they're fantastic. But I'm a big sweater, so as soon as I stopped in towns, I had to take the jacket off. And even like 10 to 15 minutes of just in a little bit of traffic, I just start sweating up underneath. And the same thing with my helmet, which is a Shubith E1 Hunter. The Shubith helmets are fantastic helmets for low noise. And I've got a couple of the Shubiths, and this E1 Hunter is no exception. However, the air ventilation with them is very poor, and so basically it's a sweat box. So you got to think about that, especially when you've got comms. You know, I've got a wireless. I don't like having the boom microphones, so I've got a wireless Euclid Digital, and that lasted me the whole trip. I didn't have any issues with the microphone or the only thing is I lost one of them I sort of left it at a mechanic in Colombia, and they couldn't find it conveniently. but anyway, so I had to buy another one of those, but that wasn't anything to do with the device's fault. But that lasted all the way through. The microphones for that, I didn't have an issue with that. The Ghost S, the microphones, I went through three microphones with that. And that may have had something to do with the sweating, I'm not sure. But it was, you take the helmet off and it's, dripping wet with water. And that usually happened through the US and through the hotter states. Is, if you get, when you get to New Orleans, you're in the traffic there for 20, 30 minutes. And the bigger cities even longer. So you're in the traffic and there's nothing you can do. You just, as soon as the sun starts hitting you and the heat outside, for me, I just sweat. And when I sweat, it's not pretty. So I had my boots were really comfortable, and I used the Climb socks that Climb makes some adventure socks, and they're really good. They actually lasted me the whole trip too. I had I had originally three pairs, and I got rid of one, and to just have the two. But I mean, the thing about it is that the gear that I had, if you counted the clothing, all the clothes that I had for the whole trip, apart from my riding gear, which I wore pretty much every day, all of that would fit into one small backpack. My socks, my t-shirts, I have these thin t-shirts I got from Russia. They're really thin material and really comfortable to wear, and I love them so much. I wear them all the time. And so I had some t-shirts, and I knew that once I got to the south, I was getting to like Santiago and Chile, I was eventually going to buy some cold weather, some underwear. But I knew I didn't need it for most of the trip, so I just didn't carry it with me. And now I was beginning to learn that you only take what you need. You don't take what you'd like to have, because it's a load. And unpacking your bike and then looking on the trolley of everything unpacked, you just think, my God, there's just a lot of stuff. But when you count everything, I had one of my side cases had all my camping equipment, not my camping gear, my camping equipment, like my stoves, my dry food, my freeze dry food, just the little tools for camp, all the little tools for camping. And in the other side pannier, I had all my tools for my bike, and I had spare a coolant, spare oil, all that sort of stuff. And eventually, that stuff had to go. I restocked that once I got to Santiago, because I was having some issues with the coolant that again wasn't anything to do with the bike, but had a lot to do with someone breaking the seal on my coolant tank and then having to get it resealed and not 100% done correctly. That was a second side case. And then because I'm working on the road, I had my computer that I needed, and then one of those computers, which had a lot of data on it that I need, was failing. So I had to get another computer just in case that just gave it in completely. And so I had two laptops in the back, and then I had all my photography equipment. So that went into the top case with the computer gear, and then all my and all the camera equipment and the cables and the battery for recharging everything. All that went into the top case, and then the two bags. One of them had my camping gear, like my sleeping bag, my mattress and pillows, and I had a hammock and stuff like that, a little mini hammock and all that stuff on that bag. And on the other bag I had my drone and my clothing, and then on top of the top case I had the tent. So there's a lot of stuff that I was carrying, And it came, it was starting to get to a situation where I just had to make a decision on what was necessary. And so once I got to New Orleans, I had two boxes, you know, 2 feet by half a foot high, 2 feet long by half a foot high, two boxes full of stuff that I was sending back. And I never thought, oh damn, I sent that back, you know, through the whole trip, because I just basically got into my head, I only need what I need, you know? So everything I had now on the bike was going to be, I thought was going to be used. Again, once I got to San Diego, I thinned down again because I was on the last, that was going to be the last leg through Patagonia, so I had to get some winter clothes on board. For this time, I basically just wanted to lighten the load. I was getting on and off the bike a lot more because I was stopping a lot more and relaxing about the whole thing a fair bit more. So I had to get on and off the bike, which meant, it basically meant getting your leg over, you know, because I've got bad knees, getting my leg over the gear each time, and having that extra thing in the middle with the extra height I just couldn't do it anymore. Unless I had a nice stretch beforehand and I was nice and lithe, I basically couldn't get my leg over sometimes, you know. Then I had to basically just step back off the bike and it was just becoming a pain. And then if you think about when you drop the bike and stuff like that, you don't want to be dropping a bike, which happens to some of the other guys that I've been speaking to, where they put their foot through where the seat is, and you know, it's never, even if you're a pretty flexible guy, that's never the perfect way, because if you hit the seat with your foot, the bike can easily tip over the other way, and that happened quite a bit to a few of the guys that I spoke to, where you know, they then had to get the bike picked up. You know, a lot of these guys were riding with somebody else, so it was okay, they had that help, but I didn't have that luxury. If I chip my bike, I've got to unpack everything off the bike. I can pick the bike up, mine's a big bike, dry, with fuel about 240 kilos, but if you're in the right position on flat land, I can pick it up easily myself, just at that. But when with the side cases and the bags, no, and it happened a couple of times, but I had to basically unpack everything. And you know, I had one day through sand, about maybe 500 meters to a kilometer of sand. It took 4 hours to get that distance. And it was basically just unpacking the gear and then walking the gear up the road as far as I could, dropping it, then going back to the bike, getting the next lot of gear, then going back to the bike, and then either trying to ride the bike or side ride the bike, which is standing next to the bike, trying to get it through that sand. And that, I can tell you now, looking back now, I'm so happy I did something like that, but at the time, I wasn't a happy camper. So yeah, so a few of the photos you've been seeing through this are basically just New Orleans photos from once I got there. Only a couple of riding photos, but getting to New Orleans, I stayed in a nice hotel, right, pretty much in the heart of, you know, only two blocks from Bourbon Street. And Bourbon Street is what it is. You know what I mean? If you're a drinker and stuff like that, it's fine. But if you do a bit of research, there's some really great restaurants and pubs in the area that are outside of that, and a lot of historic places. And it's good to go into the areas that were affected by the flooding as well, which is, still a lot of it nothing's been done, and it's a little bit sad, but a great little city, and I was really looking forward to having a couple of days break. I stayed at a place with a pool. The pool ended up being about 10 metres long by about 3 metres wide. But it was refreshing, and the room was quite nice, even though it was pretty basic. And the fact that, again, I couldn't get a room that was close to where the parking lot was, so I had to walk my bike or pay someone to do it. It's the one thing you notice in hotels is you're sort of forced into having charges. Like if you stay in a hotel, and a decent hotel, they'll grab your bags. I mean, you can't even, if you grab it, you can't have the trolley yourself. You've got to have that trolley with a guy. So each time it's like $5, $10 or whatever. And so you're forced into all these charges that you don't, you know, I mean, half the time you've got your own bags. And, you know, a couple of the hotels I stayed in, they waited for me to fill the trolley and then said, no, that you can't take the trolley yourself. So basically I had to do all the work, and then all they did is push the trolley into the lift and up, and then stood there waiting for their tip. You know, a little bit annoying. I mean, sometimes I wanted help and, you know, happy to pay for it. And other times I just had to pay for it. And I just had to pay for it, and it was my problem, you know. And so that's a little bit annoying. But for the most part, when I was looking for online for hotels to stay in, I was trying to check where the looking at photos for where the parking was, and then with my booking sending a request to say I have a motorbike, am I able to park my bike right next to my apartment? And so I looked for hotels that were sort of like one level and had motel type things that had parking at the front. I wasn't locking my bike up. I've got a security device on my bike, so it actually has tracking. It only, unfortunately, the company that does it only uses AT&T, which means it's only available to actually locate the bike in the USA, instead of perhaps being a little bit smarter and using a company like T-Mobile that actually has worldwide, pretty much nearly every country in the world covered with data. You know, it's a pretty bit of a dumb move by, they're called Find Me Now. It's a bit of a dumb move from them using AT&T. It obviously came down to costs. But I mean, if you've got a $20,000, $30,000 motorbike, you want to, you know, paying an extra $100 a year to have a service worldwide, it, you know, is some pretty good peace of mind. So I would suggest that they do that. But I had the gear for strapping, tying the bike up, and I used it a couple of times, and then I found that it wasn't worth it if you had good security with the parking, especially in Central and South America, where you'll stay in cabanas and stuff like that in small towns, and even those, and even hostels and all that had their own security guards. So, you know, you're pretty safe, you know, with your bike, and that was never going to be an issue. So yeah, anyway, so that was getting to New Orleans. Took me 7 hours, 20 minutes or so, as you can see from the river below, and it was well worth the. It wasn't a bad day's ride for me that day, because I had quite a few stops. So again, any questions or comments below? Thank you.